very great. We have the opportunity here today to actually spend some time very fruitfully in looking at quote-unquote duality, the deception of duality, because it is this that keeps us, that is causing us to keep sinking, and failing. We keep tripping ourselves up with this. So it's a very auspicious time, day, moment here to say, yes, we can look at duality and clarify it. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Now the world is saying, yes, we can continue on not clarifying it. All right, let's be very clear about that. The whole yes, we can movement in this world is really saying, yes, we can delay some more. Yes, we can refuse a little longer. Yes, we can keep the deception going a little more. Well, of course, that's possible if that's what you want. But it's also possible to say, yes, we can set it down. Yes, we can set it down. Both are possible. We can either continue self-deception or set this self-deception down for the vision of oneness, which is truth. And at the root of our troubles is our confusion about duality, our supposed confusion about duality. Okay, and let us see if we can untangle this here. I untangled it this morning, so I know it is possible. It's like a Rubik's Cube. You get it done, you know you can do it. It's doable. And it's much simpler than a Rubik's Cube, actually. But the continuity fear, of course, causes us to act incompetent, right? But I don't have an incompetency problem. I have a continuity problem. I'm not incompetent. I have a continuity fear. So this is even more key. This is the root of any practice, is to realize I have a severe continuity fear. I am not stupid. I don't have a stupidity problem. I have a continuity problem. And I'm absolutely adamant about this. Everyone can get the truth, can see it. I'm totally convinced of this. There's no one who's incapable of it. It's just that this continuity problem is so severe that we seem to be incapable. But that's only due to the continuity problem. It's not an actual fact at all. We are absolutely capable of recognizing, seeing through this, how we've tricked ourselves. So if you experience difficulty, it's because of the continuity problem. So you just say, okay, you own the continuity problem. All other problems, you don't own them. Don't own them. I don't own that. I don't own that problem. I don't own the stupidity problem. I own the continuity problem. I don't have a stupidity problem. I don't own it. I own the continuity problem. You own it and say and admit it and own it and say, yeah, I do, because I've been trying to be stupid for so long. But I'm not stupid, but I do now. I'm afraid of recognizing how intelligent I really am. It's like that. So I know everyone is capable. I know it. Because I've done it. And then the continuity fear comes back a little bit, and I say, oh, what was that again? I forgot. You know, I don't have a forgetful problem. I have a continuity problem, continuity fear. It's like, wow, if I don't forget, I'm going to experience, you know, pure, unalloyed happiness, process-free, location-free, vast, endless plenum of happiness. I said, whoa, I'm not quite ready for that, so I'm going to forget. So the forgetting is strategic. The stupidity is strategic. It's a reaction to the fear of our happiness. And we then own the fact. See, that's my problem. It's not that I'm stupid or incompetent or I'm all of this. No way. We have not lost our freedom and our perfect intelligence, none of that's been lost. We only have this continuity fear. That's the only situation that has come from our attempt to cause reality to fail. We've tried to to create a failure of reality. The only thing that's happened is we have a continuity problem. Nothing else has happened. And that's just, we're nervous to set this failure down. So when we look at this duality situation, you have to have compassion for yourself and patience. Patience and compassion instead of frustration and anger, saying, I can't get it, I must be incompetent, or are the teachers incompetent, or, you know, someone's incompetent. No, continuity problem. It's all that it is. That's why there are times you can get it, and then the fog comes back in, because you say, well, wait a minute, how do I function in this world, you know, with this realization? Whoa, I'm not sure I'll be able to function. And then you turn away from the clarity, turn away from it. That's what happens here. So, I do not have a stupidity problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a density problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't even have a duality problem, I have a continuity problem, actually. Without the continuity problem, we could see through it just like that. When you see it, it's so obvious. The idea of two-ness is just one idea. Okay, the idea of two-ness. Let's say we had this idea that the idea I'm having now is not one idea, but two ideas. Isn't that actually still one idea? The idea of an idea being two ideas? That's still one idea, isn't it? It's not two ideas. It's like saying, I have the idea of both truth and lies. Okay, is that two ideas? An idea that's a lie, an idea that's truth? Or is it one idea that's saying, I have an idea of both truth and lies? It's one idea, isn't it? Not two. So duality is just an idea of two-ness that we forget is only one idea. It's not two ideas. It's as simple as that. It's as simple as that. It's like we say, well, I have this idea of the feminine and masculine principle. That's not two principles. It's one idea of two principles. There aren't really two principles there. There's only one idea. So we tend, the way we talk about the universe, we say, oh yeah, the feminine principle, and then the masculine principle, and this is this, and this is it. None of that's true. None of that's true. But it's only one idea. Just like saying truth and lies, that's one idea, not two. So when we think it's two ideas, we think the solution comes from harmonizing the two ideas, that somehow they don't seem one to us, right? Like the feminine principle and the masculine principle, we need to relate them to one another, harmonize them, yin and yang them, you know, kind of thing. That's the delusional approach that keeps you trapped in delusion. There is no yin and yang. There is no yin and yang. There's all one idea of two-ness. It's not two ideas, it's one idea. So there's nothing that needs to be harmonized at all, except just set down the one idea. And we keep thinking, well, wait a minute, how do I set down these two ideas? Well, I set this one down, then this one here, you know, is a conflict with this, and this is how we delude ourselves. There's only one idea to set down, and that's the idea of trying to make reality fail. And the way that we hold on to this idea is to not realize it's just one idea, is to say it's two ideas. That the idea of two-ness is actually two ideas. So this is called duality, the deception of duality. It's one idea. There is no two-idea-ness. It's one idea, one idea. And when we see this, it's so obvious. We say, what? How could that account, you know, how could, well, when we think that one idea is two, this is an attempt to cause reality to fail. Because in reality, cause and effect are one, they're not two. And ideas cannot be, the will is one, it is not two. It cannot be split. So we're trying to cause reality to fail when we're insisting that one idea is two, actually two. It's split. And there's a interaction between the two ideas that is so-called creativity. That's not creativity. That's delusion. That's imagination. Imagination trying to be an end in itself. Trying to imagine that reality isn't real is what we're doing. And when we're caught in this, it seems like there's no way out of it. And then when we see it, just that this two-ness is actually one idea, it seems like the it's completely obvious. So there's this huge gap, seemingly, between the two. That's the continuity problem. Is that we think, wow, how do we get from one to the other? There's no, it's the snake of the rope thing. There never was a snake there. So we say, well, how do I get from the snake to the rope, you know? Okay, how did the snake become the rope? Or how did the rope become the snake? It never did. So in the delusion of duality, we're trying to figure out, okay, how's the yin and yang work? It doesn't work. There is no yin and yang. We're trying to figure out, how can we harmonize the male and female principles? There are no male and female principles. That's a delusion. There's only one idea of trying to make reality fail. So there's only one idea to set down. There's nothing that needs to be harmonized. And so we spend all our time trying to harmonize two-ness. There is no two-ness. Again, it is like saying, rope and the snake, the analogy, and most of you probably know what that is. Someone's walking along and they see a snake and they go, oh my God, and they're screaming to everybody, help, 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 there's a poisonous snake, I'm all scared. And then somebody comes along and says, that's not a snake, it's just a rope in the road, and you thought it was a snake. And then they say, well, what happened to the snake then? I mean, I see the rope now, yeah, but what happened to the snake? And then people are thinking, okay, how did the rope become a snake, and then the snake again turned back into the rope? So there's two, there's a rope and a snake, and they're interchanging. No, there never was a snake there. There was never a rope there either. You see, both are false. There was an idea of a rope snake-ness, but that's one idea. So we're trying to figure out, well, how do we, you know, which principle is right, the feminine or the masculine? You know, which is supposed to dominate? Which is supposed, we think the way to oneness is to have one principle dominate the other and get rid of the other. But there are no principles, actually. There are no principles. Never has been. There's an idea of two-ness. The idea of two-ness is not two-ness. It's oneness. So we never did get oneness to fail. See, we're trying to get oneness to fail. So of course we insist there's two-ness. But it's not. It's oneness. It's still oneness. We never have had two-ness. And so when I say, listen to these videos in the mood of repentance, which is how to absorb the shock of breakthroughs, this is what I'm talking about. There's never been two-ness. And until we can absorb the shock of that realization, we will continue to flail away in all these conflicts. Once one quote-unquote side dominating another, then the other dominating another, and all the games of subterfuge and cleverness, all the stuff we really hate, you know, that just is so sticky and horrible, we will continue on with all of that unless we're able to absorb the impact of this realization. So really the most important, I will say among the most important, if not the most, of the spiritual path, of how you spend your time, is to be in the mood of repentance, which says I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. That means I have a problem absorbing the truth, the shock of the truth. However, we have faith that if we are patient and quiet and still and humble enough and attentive enough and are not argumentative or reactive or emotional or intellectual, if we don't go into any of those modes, we hold ourselves just to simplicity, simple realization. And I keep saying the realization is utterly simple, meaning very humble, right? That we're not looking for some real sophisticated explanation of anything. Then we'll be able to absorb the shock of this. It's becoming an expert shock absorber is really what the path is all about. You've heard some of the great sages say, just be still, just be quiet. This is what they're talking about. Because the realization, again, is utterly simple and final. And that's a shock. Because we've been trying to figure out how to harmonize and blend these two principles. There are no two principles. There's nothing to blend. There's nothing to harmonize. This is what the Holy Spirit told me one morning, my spiritual practice for the days is, I don't need to harmonize anything. I said, what? Yeah. I don't need to harmonize or arrange. I don't need to arrange anything or harmonize anything. That was the practice. And I kind of said, like, that's kind of an odd practice. But I kind of did it anyway. Again, there's nothing to arrange or rearrange. There's nothing to harmonize or disharmonize at all. There's never been two principles. Remember, the idea of failure presupposes two-ness, does it not? It says that which is, and then that, and then that, then the failure of that which is. Whereas if you don't have the idea of failure, where's the two-ness? You simply have that which is. There is no two-ness to that. The idea of failure is intrinsically a belief in two-ness, the rope and the snake. But the truth is there was neither a rope nor a snake. There was only one idea, not two. There was not an idea of a rope and an idea of a snake. Though the idea of the rope snake was the idea of failure, one idea. The idea of failure is one idea, not two. And this hit me, you know. It's hit me just doing this video. I'm struck. There's only been one the entire time. Just one idea the whole time. And, you know, this causes an aching inside, a feeling like, almost like a collapse. It's just like, you know, everything I've been doing, all these efforts were just completely ridiculous. Trying to figure out how did that rope turn into a snake? And how did that snake turn back into the rope? No, none of that happened. There's only the idea of rope snakeness. All of our efforts have been to keep the idea of failure alive by claiming there's two-ness. That the idea of failure is two-ness, that there's success and then there's failure. No, it's just one idea of failure, which of course has to be applied, seen as being applied to success. Because if you're not causing success to fail, what is failing? Then what is failure? Failure has to be of success, right? It's like the failure of oneness. What can the failure of oneness be except two-ness, right? So the idea of failure is intrinsically the idea of two-ness. Intrinsically so. It is not organically so. It is not an organic two-ness. There isn't any actual two-ness. It's intrinsic by the very nature of this idea. It has to assume two-ness. If there is no failure of reality, how can there be doness? There cannot be. And so the trouble is the reaction to this realization. That's the trouble. To the extent that we can absorb it, then our minds remain clear. When we feel like, oh my gosh, you know, I don't know if I can, I feel like I'm just being collapsed or something, then we'll kind of panic and we'll get intellectual about it or something. Or emotional, intellectual. But I'm feeling it powerfully right now. So we're just sharing this. It's like, wow, it just struck me. I get it. You know, I saw it. I said, oh, wow. And it's kind of shocking. It's shocking. Shocking feeling. So generally, I would say on a successful spiritual path, a lot of the time you will be kind of in this sort of shocked, stunned condition. I feel like, holy cow. See, a lot of people equate the spiritual path with joy. That success means, oh, I'm happy, happy, happy all the time. And they act bubbly and effervescent. And so those people who have this ability to be bubbly and effervescent, oftentimes it's different types. Sometimes it's the big person's jolly, all the jolly person. Other times it's the little small person who comes to be very bubbly and effervescent, right? And we think, oh, they're having so much success on the spiritual path. I don't see it that way at all. Because I can tell you, I just saw that there's only one, and I'm not feeling bubbly or effervescent at all. Feeling like shocked and just the opposite of bubbly and effervescent, let's put it that way. I'm not depressed because I'm facing it, I'm owning it. I own that I have a continuity problem, I'm owning it. And I want it, I'm embracing it. But there's no way around feeling shocked about it when you see it. I just saw it, I just like, wow. And so you just give yourself, honor yourself. Honor your creativity in trying to deceive yourself. You're bound to have this feeling of like, holy cow, the whole thing is just a deception. There was never any tunis. This whole time I've been assuming that there was this tunis, and I'm trying to fix the tunis and get it to work, and that's all totally in vain. Totally unnecessary. Nothing to harmonize, nothing to arrange. There's always been only the one. So, you know, don't be fooled. What I find is that it's so difficult thinking that there's something wrong with you because you're kind of like crestfallen. But it's not a depressed, I'm very happy that I've seen this. But there's a part of us that is like, just saying, wow, I've just played myself for a sucker all this time. And there's part of us that's kind of crestfallen. The crest has fallen, you know? The crests of all the waves, I realize, it's just one ocean, you know? There's not many waves. There's just one wave. One idea of many waves. But not many waves, actually. So, you know, I really feel that the whole notion, the modern notion of the spiritual path is something where success is measured by how happy and joyful you are, is incorrect. Now, I know this flies in the face of some of what my teacher has said, etc., but from my own experience, I'm going on this. It is indisputably that you feel devastated to some extent. There's a certain measure of devastation with realizing the scope, and also the shock of saying, "Oh my God, what if I hadn't have seen this? What unlimited delusion there is!" You know, it's also that shock. When you pull back from the abyss, you realize you're sitting on the edge of this abyss. You pull back from it. You say, "Oh my God, you know, what if I hadn't have pulled back from it?" It's like that. So eventually this will eventuate in happiness. But I know that the atmosphere to help others out on a spiritual path needs to be this repentant atmosphere. I would say for many. Now maybe there is some path of happiness and joy that somehow some can take, but I would say for many, it needs to be an atmosphere that is not requiring you to act in an effervescent, bubbly way. Otherwise, you won't get to this insight, because this insight causes you to be crestfallen. This recognition. And you say, "I'm sorry, I just don't feel like marching in the parade right now." I think a lot of people drug themselves to try and keep up with the parade, thinking that they're supposed to be happy, happy, joy, joy here. You know, we're harmonizing and arranging stuff. No, there's nothing to harmonize or arrange. Nothing whatsoever. And you can say, all the time I've been spending believing in time is completely wasted time, a total waste. Nothing ever happened. Never needed to do anything. Never needed to do anything. So that's a shock to the system, no question about it. Now it will wear off, but it's a shock. And so when people go to a place of worship, when they go to, I do feel it's a necessity to not require people to be happy, happy, joy, joy. And to make it very clear, it's okay to be crestfallen. It's okay to be crestfallen. Not promoting tears. That's avoiding the crestfallenness. This is beyond tears. It's beyond depression. It's not suicidal. It's not anything like that. It is this genuine crestfallenness. So there's a genuineness to it, which feels good. The crestfallenness is a good feeling, you know, but it is crestfallenness too. It's like a good crestfallenness. It's the cure for depression, actually. It's the cure for depression. You see, depression arises in a society which insists on joy, joy, happy, happy, bubbly, effervescent physicality-ness. And people are told they're wrong to feel this crestfallenness. And so they're depressed, that they think there's something wrong about it. Whereas I'm saying, no, this is genuine. There's nothing wrong about this whatsoever. I embrace it. And so it's not depression. I'm not depressed whatsoever over this. It's the cure for depression. And the funny thing is the last couple months I've not been able to sleep. I've been depressed, because I've been battling to get to this point. And the last couple of nights I've slept through very nicely, and my dreams have been amazingly good. It's showing me some amazing resolution is coming here for me. This is the, you know, it's the end of depression. When you can embrace and honor your crestfallenness, your true crestfallenness, there's no opportunity for harmony or arranging. See, that's it. There isn't any, "I can harmonize." So the whole, you know, this whole harmonizer or arranger that we've been believing in, which we call ourself or our I, there isn't any such I. No opportunity for it, so how could there be such a self? The personal standpoint is totally moot now. Because there's nothing to harmonize or arrange whatsoever. I'm just being crestfallen here, which is great. You know, the theme of the world, fun, fun, fun. If you're not having fun, you're not enjoying creation, is what they tell you. What utter nonsense that is. Leads to depression. We have an epidemic of depression and anxiety among younger people here in the world, and I absolutely have dedicated myself to being helpful on that, because I fell victim to that myself. You know, people might go to a church and say, "Why everybody's somber here, serious?" And I say, "It's crazy. I want to have fun. Let's go out to California. Let's have go to the beach and have fun, 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 fun." And they raise their children and say, "Come on, kids, helicopter parents, it's time to have more fun. It's time to have more fun." And, you know, the kids are saying, "Wow, you know, there's something wrong with this world. I feel I need to do, there's something serious, some serious problem here. I mean, no, you're not happy today? Come on, let's go out and, you know, play. Let's do, you know, let's go take a hike. There's pressure from society, from these helicopter parents, to have fun, fun, fun. There's something wrong with you not having fun. If you're not, look, there's so much to harmonize, so much to arrange, so many problems to fix. Come on, let's make it fun. Let's be active." And the kids end up committing suicide. They get on antidepressants and anxiety medications, and those don't work. And the parents never change their behavior. They say, "Well, there's nothing wrong with me. I'm just trying to have my kid have fun. What's wrong with me? Nothing. Everything is wrong with that." That's where the problem is. You know, we want our saints to be these wild and wacky, crazy wisdom saints who are helping us have fun, more fun. I'm telling you for sure that there's a deep ache that comes here. Not a depression, not at all. You should be able to pick up, "I'm not depressed, I'm crestfallen," for sure. But there's an inner, like, yes to it. Like, wow, this is great. There's a knowing, there's an inner knowing. Like, yeah, you're getting it. You're really getting it. So depression it comes upon those who are capable now of getting it, and the culture is demanding they not get it, that they keep propping up this insanity of fun, 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 of rearranging and harmonizing, when there are no two principles. This is already one. If it's already one, what is there to harmonize? There is no disharmony. There is no disharmony. There is no lack of order. It's all perfect. It's all totally perfect, as the great sages say. And therefore there is no I, the harmonizer, I, the rearranger, I, the peacemaker. There is no such thing. So it's kind of like what I'm experiencing is there's like evaporating is taking place. And I don't feel like going out and having fun. No, no. I could, but I prefer not to, actually. It's a preference. That's why young people want to get into meditation, contemplation. But that doesn't get to the root of it, does it? Because society is sick. The world, the whole world, is a sickness, as it were. Is a desire to cause reality to fail, to cause one to be two. One is still one. And all this two-ness has never been two-ness. It's always been oneness. So more important than the rhetoric is the reaction to it. So that's what I'm just filming here. And my videos have been that, is just to show it's okay. It's okay to react. It's not like a sin, you know. The world wants to turn you and say, you're the sinner, you know. They would look at me and say, you're the worst sinner of all. Because you're accepting defeat or something. I'm saying there's never been any situation that can be defeat. There's never been any victory. There's never been defeat. Victory doesn't exist. That duality doesn't exist. Never has existed. So by allowing this feeling, the potential for depression is evaporating. Potential for anxiety is evaporating. I almost had a nervous breakdown yesterday of hanging around someone who has this fun idea. And I felt so wrong. You know, I started feeling so wrong about myself. I said, conflicted. So it's not good to hang around the fun crowd. It is not. The, you know, we gotta go here, we gotta do this, we gotta take this vacation, we gotta, you know, we gotta stay busy, happy. If we stop being happy, we'll not be happy. If we stop having fun, we won't be happy. Now, you look at the great sages throughout history, and they could just sit there like a statue in total bliss, not even aware of anything going on in the world at all, or aware of everything and realizing nothing needs to be done whatsoever. They're not fanatics. There's a new word. Don't be a fanatic. Don't be fanatical. Just coined a new word. Word is a good word. We don't need to be fanatical. So I welcome this shock. I love it. I wish I could, you know, just that the society, there's a stigma attached to it. So it's hard to get to. As I said, this culture, world culture, is incredibly stigmatic as far as it stigmatizes realization as being defeatist and negative and wrong and depressive and stuff. No, it's only because they think they have to do both, harmonize something, that they think it is depression. So for them, the way they see it, it's depression, but it's not. Seeing oneness is not depression. But the two-ness, the crests of the two-ness are crestfallen. Crestfallen, you realize, I don't need to do anything. It's a shock. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to be anything. there's a tram, right? I don't need to know anything. So you can't be a helicopter parent on the path. That doesn't work. I think people have children in order to keep themselves in this fun mode. Like, oh, I got a kid, the kid wants to have fun. And so I gotta do this, and it keeps them busy. See, I never had the slightest desire for kids, never. Because I saw what it's all about. You know, it's all about reinforcing your notion that you need to keep having fun, busy. And you use the kids as an excuse. That's what I found out. I found out parents use their kids as an excuse. And they actually, a lot of kids don't like it. Some do, because they're like-minded, you know. But some deep old souls, they don't like that at all. They just leave me alone. I just wanna sit here and quietly, I just wanna be quiet. I don't wanna have fun. I'm not into fun. I say, no, come on, we gotta go on vacation. It'll be fun for you. I say, no, I'd rather just stay right here. They say, what's the matter with you? You're depressed or something. It's like they drag you on vacations, keep you doing fun. And what happens? You get depressed. Gotta want to go to school. A lot of fun things at school. No, just distractions. I hated school. Absolutely hated school. I didn't want to go to school at all. Didn't need school. I had reading, writing, and arithmetic. By the time, you know, second, third grade, that was enough. I had already knew how to read, knew how to do all basic math. You know? I knew whatever I needed to know, I knew by second grade. That was enough. Then, leave me alone. I'm working on accepting this crestfallenness. But the parents say, oh, he's over there in a corner thinking, he's depressed. No, not at all. I'm actually accepting my blessedness, you know, the blessedness of oneness. I'm just evaporating all the pressure of the world. Often sages are You wonder if autistic children are not actually, it's a defense against fun. They're saying, I'm not able to function that way, you know? They don't want to interact socially. See, they don't want to have fun. Is autism really a disease? Or is it a desire for a cure, actually? Is a question. Or is it society trying to keep forcing things, forcing more children, forcing this whole thing to keep going, fun, because they don't want to feel crestfallen, because they think it's an abyss or something. And by forcing it, they get autistic children. See? Everyone's looking for what's causing autism and stuff, you know, what is it, vaccinations? No. It's a spiritual situation. We're trying to force things. When we stop trying to force things, if people choose to have children, they won't be autistic anymore. Because you will not be trying to force the child into this world of fun, which, when the world is too much that way, spirit coming into this, identifying with form, there's a resistance, there's automatic saying, whoa, this is too much. And then there's a wall there that prevents them from participating in that fun. Whereas if it wasn't that way, then spirit would not feel that way, and the child would not be autistic, actually. Remember, genetics and DNA, all that stuff is just a reflection of desire. So it's the curse of this fun world is all these autistic children and depressed children and this whole problem. That's the curse. It's the society that's sick. We're forcing it. We're overdoing it. We've gone down the wrong path. We're going down a dead end. And now we've got all these children and they're all on these medications. You know? Or they're hyperactive. These hyperactive children who can't stop having fun. It's obsessive. See, all of this is this terrible situation in the world. And the remedy is the spiritual path. The remedy is spiritual teachers. The remedy is these centers of sobriety, true sobriety centers. A true sobriety center is the places where you can come and it's okay to be crestfallen. That's supportive. And again, not emotional, no. It's not therapy like that. You go scream and yell at your parents and blah, 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 blah. No, that's not the cure. I've been through the entire thing and I know. What works and what doesn't work. And it's this allowance of this genuine crestfallenness. I failed at failure. It's like that, wow. Failure is a failure. You cannot avoid success. You cannot avoid oneness. It's impossible. Allowing this to be experienced is how you cure the situation. And ultimately, a good therapist, and there are, I assume, good therapists, is allowing the patient to say, it's okay here, it's okay to feel crestfallen. Genuinely crestfallen. But, you know, I don't know how many therapists are like that. You know, it doesn't work. You can get some relief from just feeling it's okay to feel depressed. You can get some relief from that, but it's not the cure. The real cure is the realization that you can never truly be depressed. You can never fail. You can never fail. So you're a failure at failure. You're a failure at depression. You're a failure at anxiety. You can never be truly anxious. You can never be truly depressed. You can never truly fail. And of course, we see failure as success. So there has to be this allowance to understanding that it is not success. It is setting down failure where we realize that we're intrinsically successful. We can never fail to be what we are. And so most therapists are not yet at that place. They're not yet there. But they can, the patient comes to a therapist, and the therapist is really also the patient of the patient. And together, they're helping reinforce one another, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. Times the patient is helping the therapist more than the therapist helping the patient. The only problem is the patient, the therapist is getting all the money. But, of course, by the patient helping the therapist, the patient is getting tremendous help too. So they're getting a payment from that too, actually. Yeah. That's one way to look at it, right? I mean, it's really the patient that's helping the therapist. The therapist is just not quite yet able to do it without the social camouflage of saying, no, I'm helping others, I'm a therapist, and say, okay. They really are trying to come to this realization themselves, but they can't publicly admit it yet. So they have the title psychotherapist, psychiatrist, this and this and that. And they have patients come to them to help them out, actually. A lot of cases. but they're not quite, they, you know, they're a little scared to admit they're on the path. So they say, no, I'm helping the patient out. And I got this title and everything that proves that I'm legit. So, you know, don't worry. Don't worry. I'm not a failure. I'm not a failure. The whole thing about degrees and stuff is just to say to somebody, hey, I'm not a failure. I'm not a failure. Don't worry. But again, all those people with degrees and all that stuff, it's just a camouflage, a smokescreen. Because they really want to accept that they're a failure at failure, their intrinsic success. But they don't, you know, it's a way to push the pressure. They don't want too much pressure on them, you know, right? So that's fine. All these achievements that we're doing, we're just again, it's a camouflage, smokescreen. A lot of people pursuing all those high degrees. They're saying, God, I just want to get enough cachet so that I can finally fail. You know, fail at failure. And people let me say, okay, we're not worried about him. I just want to get on the path. You know, there's a way people want to get on the spiritual path. They get all these degrees and advanced, so they say, okay, can I, is it okay now? You know, it's like that. It's really like that. And me, when I was young, I said, I don't need any degrees. I don't need anything. I don't need any success. Forget it. People said, what are you talking about? You got to have some success here. I said, no. I want to quit school. I don't need any schooling. He said, no, you got to get your degrees. You got to go to college, get your this and this and that. No. And they said, oh, you're a failure, huh? I said, no. I'm a success. It's this world that's a failure. It's the attempt at failure that's the failure. And people just didn't get it. They didn't get it. Thank God there's had a few teachers that seem to get it. Not in these exact words, you know, but everyone's path has to be organic anyway. Same with riches. People pursue riches. What are they really, really pursuing? They're really pursuing their desire to set down all this, set it down. But they feel they need to appease something. You know what? The continuity problem. If once you see that the continuity problem is your real problem, the desire to waste all this time pursuing all these advanced degrees and riches and all this stuff, you'll say, ah, I don't want to waste. It's a waste of time. It is a waste of time. There's a much quicker way. Is to have a severe continuity problem. Vision of oneness is the remedy for this. All I need to do is work on the severe continuity problem. I recognize I have a severe problem, and it's okay to feel very crestfallen, you know, when I realize I never needed to do anything. I never needed to do anything. I never needed to be anything. I never needed to know anything. I never needed to harmonize anything. I never needed to arrange anything. Everything is always, there's only perfection. So don't be fooled by all these bigwigs. A lot of times they can change and say, all that was just a ruse, you know, it was just, you know, just a waste of time. They repent, they do. The big business person, the big academic, some of those people repent, actually. The big celebrities, all they do. They do. They just say, heck with this. I realize it was just a waste of time. I don't need this anymore. I don't need it. Some of them do. But, and equally to the point is this epidemic of depression. And it's brutal. It is brutal. We live in a brutal civilization and society. Brutal. The more we push fun on people, the more brutal it becomes. There's no question about it. They say, well, if you don't have fun, you'll have misery. No. The fun is the misery. If we don't have to push all this fun on everybody, we'll have bliss, actually. Unalloyed happiness. Uncaused happiness. And so when I rail against the world, it's for good reason, because it's generating this epidemic of severe suffering among young people and people of all ages. Young people are especially susceptible to it. They use drugs to try desperately cope with it. I'm not putting anybody down for using drugs of any type, prescription or non-prescription, illicit drug, all that stuff. I'm saying what the remedy is, and the drugs are not the remedy. Now, I'm not saying that people are using drugs to get off of them either. I'm saying that accepting that the real problem, the only real problem, is the continuity problem, and insisting on that, insisting on it, insisting on it, without question, you'll gradually diminish your drug use. And at some point, you'll just say, I don't need it anymore, for sure. What I am pointing out is this fun, massive problem in the world is now co-opted the whole drug use thing and saying, hey, this is all part of having fun. You can have even more fun because you can medicate yourself, your depression, and keep having more fun. And that leads to even heavier drug use eventually and even worse depression. If not heavier drug use, worse depression. Or both. Both. Oftentimes. So that's what I'm pointing out. I'm saying be very smart, wise, and say, wait a minute. I got to turn to the spiritual path here. And it's not that bad. And if you have those who have accepted, gone through the crestfallenness, you're going to say, you know what? I can do it too. It's not that bad. And again, see, I've been very crestfallen now, but I'm able to talk, able to relate, able to be very intelligent, able to be spot on, able to give right advice, okay? But inside, I'm feeling this wonderful crestfallenness. If you can use those terms, and it is, it's a wonderful crestfallenness. I'm very pleased, you know, very pleased. I'm just not giving the crude, crass, funness that all these marketers or advertisers are pushing on everybody. Those are the real dope peddlers, you know. Really, that's the hard stuff they're peddling. I'm telling you. People are pushing all this entertainment and movies and commercial goods and fashion and all this fun. Those are the ones who are the hard drug pushers. They're pushing the hard drugs, the real dangerous stuff. That's a fact. Because all that stuff is a drug. Very, very nasty drug. And people are saying, whoa, I don't want that drug. Okay, let's make a deal. I'll smoke pot and try to stay away from those drugs. But that's not a good solution. It's a very uneasy thing, and the marketers are way too smart for you. And they've co-opted that too. It's a half-assed remedy. You know, it doesn't work. But at least the intentions are to try to back away from the fun. You know, the intentions are okay. But good intentions don't necessarily mean that it works. So you have to combine good intentions with genuine, intuitive intelligence with what is actually going to cure the situation. See, because the problem is if you're used to smoking pot or using various drugs, when you're feeling this crestfallenness, the ego will instantly jump in and tell you, whoa, you're going to go into some terrible tailspin here. Medicate. And you'll say, light up a joint for sure. For sure. 100% for sure. So you won't be able to get. And you will have never get to this point, because there'll be 1,000 other points in between, where and 1,000 more of breakthroughs. Well, you'll the ego will tell you, light up a joint. You know, this is a problem. You're going to get depressed. You're unhappy. Now, I'm actually ecstatic that I've gotten to this point. But you see, genuine ecstaticness actually is this smoothed out. still, peaceful bliss. So I can tell I'm getting there, you see. It's not that I'm dancing on nightclubbing or something. Yeah, no. That's avoiding this. That's how you avoid this. So I'm the guy that did not go to parties, did not go to nightclubs, did not do this, did not go to concerts, did not, you know, participate in all this fun. I'm the one who tried the best of my capacity. Now, there were times when I did get sucked into that. But there was some intelligence there, so whoa, wait. You know, in this world, it's very likely you will get sucked into some fun dynamic. Maybe very intense, that you think, well, maybe this is so much fun, it's going to work. But then, you know, it doesn't work, and then you back off and say, okay, you have to have intelligence, say, okay, that didn't work, let's get focused on what works here. It's almost inevitable. So there's no judgment, I don't judge anybody. I'm just saying, gotta be smart and get to work. Gotta get smart, be smart, and get to work on what does work. It's important to not have a secondary reaction to this. You feel this crestfallenness, and yet I'm saying, yeah, this is great. I love this crestfallenness. Support it. I adore this crestfallenness. I'm so happy for this crestfallenness. It's so wonderful. It is absolutely wonderful. I'm thrilled. I'm ecstatic. This is ecstatic crestfallenness. This is blissful crestfallenness. This is joyful crestfallenness. This is jubilant crestfallenness. This is exhilarating crestfallenness. This is inspiring crestfallenness. Support your crestfallenness. And then you don't have that secondary reaction when you think there's two-ness. You don't get confused. Whereas if you start blubbering, you know, and crying, and I'm so sad, I need a good cry, then you've confused everything. That's why I stay centered in the mood of repentance. You're not going to give the reactiveness. Okay. Now, pointing out our intrinsic success by saying, I'm jubilant, I'm inspired, that is the right way to do it. You acknowledge I'm very crestfallen, almost devastated, and you know, that the whole self-concept, the I, whatever you want to call it, the effort to harmonize and arrange was all totally delusive. And you say, well, why am I so crestfallen? You know, well, because I've spent lifetimes doing that. I mean, the lifetime previous to this, what did I do? I spent my entire life arranging and harmonizing notes, musical notes, entire lifetime, totally dedicated to that, entirely dedicated to it. And I was a craftsman, a great craftsman at arranging notes to sound harmonious. You know, I was a great craftsman, and I got tremendous applause for that, and tremendous status and approval. And now I realize, you know, totally bogus. The approval of the world is totally bogus. So much applause. I got so much applause and cheers and bravo and you're the greatest. Thank you so much. And so much thanks from so many people saying, you've just made my life so wonderful. You know, what you've done is so incredible. We just love you. So much approval from society. I got so much approval from society in general. Huge worldwide approval, actually. And it was all completely bogus. Totally misleading. It was just helping people have more advanced fun, you know. So they could avoid this recognition. It was just distraction. And so this life, I said, where's all the approval? Nothing. I said, well, what's going on? They said, well, where? They said, well, where's the distraction? I said, well, I already did a lot of distraction last life. And they say, well, it doesn't matter. We need distraction right now. and we need better distraction. Because the distraction you did before is no longer distracting us very good enough. So we need new music, you know, new distraction. And I said, no, I'm tired of that. I'm tired of that. My heart's just not in it totally, because I thought I could buy a ticket. I wouldn't have to come back here, but I did have to come back. So I'm very crestfallen about having to come back here. And they said, well, no, that doesn't work. We want someone who's, you know, who can be all in, you know, with this fun, and you're not all in. You can tell your heart's not in it. And so you're nothing. You're nobody. No applause for you. No applause for you. And then, of course, all the applause we get supports the I notion, right? And so I felt like my I concept, the one who is good at arranging and harmonizing, it is nobody likes that anymore. And so then that I was without the sense of support for the I. And that was scary, because then I said, well, I'm going to feel very crestfallen then. And then society didn't support this crestfallenness that I was going through, so it turned into depression. Now you could say, I didn't support it enough either. Yeah, but also, there is no support for it in society. That's why I was desperate to go to India, go to the East, find somewhere where people, culture is supportive of this. You know, many people went to India, went to the East, who had this problem growing up in a house that was nothing but success, fun, success. You got to be money rich, success at rich. They say, no, I don't want this. I want to fail. I want to fail at failure. I want to fail at failure. This is all a failure. I want to fail at. I want to set it down. This society doesn't support this. So they went to India looking desperately for a place. And they met with limited success at that, you know, limited success. So maybe it helped them some a little bit, but the culture was so different. It just didn't work so well. Maybe a little boost in various ways. But what happened was a lot of them who went to India, they ended up using drugs for their, you know, to medicate themselves, to say, hey, I'm, you know, drugs are a great excuse, right, to say, well, I'm not succeeding. They don't want to admit that I really don't want to succeed at failure. It's not allowed to say this. So they say, yeah, I'm an alcoholic. I'm an alcoholic, and that's why I'm a failure. See, that's the excuse. Society allows that. That society encourages that. It's amazing living here in the Bay Area. What enablers the Bay Area is of failure, blaming failure on substance abuse. Oh, you have substance abuse? Oh, great. I understand totally. That's great. Great. Let's get you into therapy. That's wonderful. I'm so tolerant of you. You know, we have this obsessive tolerance in the Bay Area and liberal society in general of being ecstatically supportive of all sorts of failure. There's only one failure that we do not support at all, and that's to accept the failure of failure. A liberal society, progressive society, is fanatically intolerant of just that one failure, the failure of failure. But they're very supportive of, oh, you've got a drug habit? Oh, what kind? You know, okay, you're on this and this and this. Okay, well, maybe we can get you on this and this. Well, that's okay. That's great, you know. You know, it's fine. I understand why you can't get a job and you can't succeed at this, and because you got this drug habit. That's great. Let's get you in therapy and we'll get you back on the road to success, you know, or something. You see? It's like that. So it's a very clever, you know, progressive liberal society is very clever, very clever. And, you know, I saw through it intuitively as a child. But it's a tough one to part that curtain is a tough one. Because they seem very tolerant. See, they're only intolerant of one thing. They're tolerant of everything else. They're only intolerant of celebrating your crestfallenness and accepting it, that there is no such thing as succeeding at failure. And there's never been two-ness. There's only been oneness. There's nothing that needs to be harmonized or treated or fixed or arranged. Nothing. See, that is what they reject categorically, a priori, totally. So they say, well, we're tolerant of everything except one thing. So we're super great people, very enlightened people. I say, no. Because what you are, you're tolerant of delusion, of delay, and completely intolerant of setting that delay down. Setting the delay down is just one idea, and that's what everybody has to do. So liberal progressive society is the problem in the world, actually. It's the dead end. It's the wrong way. But it is a very tough nut to crack. And, you know, some of us are working to crack it. I'm certainly am working to crack it. What tougher place to crack it than the Bay Area? You know, San Francisco Bay Area. I mean, it is the heart of progressive liberalism in the world, actually. California in general. What, you know, is the heart of fun? It's Hollywood. It's drug central, you know, also. And it's therapy central, right? All the therapies come out of California. Except the only thing that hasn't come out of California, actually, is what I'm doing. But it is coming out of California now. At least there's very little of that. Very little of it. So I'm part of whatever has come out of California that is genuine realization. I'm part of that. If you can do it here, you can do it anywhere, for sure. Basically, liberalism, progressivism is the ego's best defense at this time. It's its best defense. The ego says, yeah, we just got to find the right medication. And we say, we understand you're just seekers for the right medication, and maybe we can find it. Now that liberals are saying, oh yeah, maybe there's some ethnogens, they're it. You know, yeah, we just have to find the right drug, is what they're saying, basically. The right excuse, you know. But no, that doesn't do it. But can you get through to them? I don't know. I've never gotten through to them, liberal progressives. No way. They're fanatical about it. Because it's a way to avoid feeling this crestfallenness, which, because of the continuity problem, can feel like you're falling into an abyss. If you have not taken the spiritual path, you will misinterpret it. So I would say liberal progressivism is based on a misinterpretation, a severe misinterpretation, a refusal to recognize that they have a continuity problem, a refusal. They say, no, we don't have a continuity problem, we have a medication problem. We just have to find the right medic. They say, no, we don't have a continuity problem, we have a therapy problem. We have to find the right therapy, the right medication, the right tolerance and stuff. They tolerate everything except this feeling of crestfallenness. And accepting and embracing it and saying, yeah, this is true, that it's all has always only been one. There is no two-ness. There is no harmony arranging. Nothing has to happen. I don't have to know anything, don't have to be anything, don't have to do anything. That is rejected as being fanatical or, you know, reactionary or something. So there is a modern disease, there's no question about it. And you know, the children go from anxiety, depression, to drugs, to a lot of them suicide, actually. And the liberal progressives, they never get it. They don't get it. They, just don't get it. But we gotta crack that nut, because that's what is, right? And that's what's happening right now. Yeah, that nut has to be cracked. And it's not being cracked by conventional conservatism, okay? Conservatives are not cracking the liberal nut. They know it's wrong, but they're not cracking it. They're going into ghost dancing mode, you know? They're frustrated. Because they say, wait, we know this doesn't work. But they're not able to show what does work. So it doesn't crack the liberal nut. You know, it doesn't crack him. And the more that conservatives are bashing the liberals, the crazier the liberals get, the progressive liberals, the crazier they get, the more fanatical they become about, you know, they want to record every conversation you have and go over the conversation, and they say, I'm sure I can find something here to throw you in jail for. Some intolerance here. There must be some intolerance here. All the while not realizing they're the ones who are intolerant of genuine realization. They're terrified of it. So how to confront a liberal, how to help a liberal, that's the big question in the world actually right now. That is the big question. And I've been working on this here in Liberal Central, and I still don't have the answer exactly. I'm praying to the Holy Spirit that I get the answer, because it literally is the sickness of the planet right now. It is how our sickness is presenting itself. And the liberals say, well, if I'm not this way, I'm going to go turn into some redneck, you know, some conservative, crazy, radical, right-wing redneck. You know, they're so terrified of that. No, that's not true. It's not true. It's all a battle of what kind of fun I have, right? The conservatives say, you shouldn't be having so much fun, you know, this is how you have fun. And then liberals say, no, we need more fun, sex, drugs, rock and roll, come on, more fun. And, but neither side, neither of that understands that it's all a defense. That when everyone needs to turn to and accept they have a continuity problem, which is what religion is supposed to do. But they've lost the edge to their message is the problem. The edge to the message isn't there. It's not. It's not being, I can say, I've studied both, the whole thing. Conservatives are not presenting truth to liberals properly at all. They're not presenting it properly. Which is why liberals are rejecting it. They say, no. It's all. But remember, this is a play of failure. Failure to communicate between the two sides is part of this belief that failure is possible. So it's all it's a dance of failure that's happening in this world. And there should be some conservatives and should be some liberals who realize this, say, whoa, wait a minute. There's something screwy here. I'm more intelligent than this. Maybe you have these independents who are saying, you know, whoa. This is a dance between two sides that are trying to just prove that there are two sides, when in fact there aren't. There's one idea of two-sidedness, but it's just one idea. I tried to bring in the great sages into this situation and said, folks, turn your attention to this. This is what's going to save you. People were not interested. The cats and dogs. I mean, it's like a dog fight. The cats and dogs are a cat fight. And they're so into this polarization thing They're just trying to prove that there is polarization. Folks, there is no polarization. It's never existed. That's the realization. It's never existed. We don't really have a liberal conservative problem. We don't really have an atheist religion problem. We really don't have any problems at all. Except the continuity problem. So the real step to realization and genuine happiness is the intermediate step is to accept you have a continuity problem, and that's the only problem you have. Because really, we don't have any problem at all, and that's a problem for us. It's a continuity problem for us. Because we've been believing that we have a problem for so long. The idea of not having any problem at all is like, how would I function? You know, I mean, Jesus says like that there's no such thing as form in reality. And he says you can imagine anything you want and any experience. I said, well, wait a minute. How do you imagine experience without form? It seems impossible, right? That's our problem, is we can't imagine any experience without it being form-based, right? But in fact, in reality, there's no such thing as form. Jesus says, only content. And we say, how can there be content without form? So that's a continuity issue. It's a continuity issue. So the fact that there is no problem is a huge continuity problem for us. But we have to accept this and say, I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. This is the absolute key to resolving this whole issue, the situation, the world, the belief that we have all these problems. Because the polarity gain, the desire to show that we do have a problem is so intense now, and it's gonna keep snowballing. I mean, these landslides that we're having is a very bad sign, actually. Remember, this whole world is just a dream of spirit. Just like when we fall asleep and we have dreams at night, well, this planet, so-called planet, is just a dream of spirit. So the stuff that's happening here is really happening in the dream of spirit. This is what's happening in the spirit's dream. And when you start having these massive mudslides burying people, you know, burying, you know, just village after village, just burying these villages, and that's a very bad sign. It's a very bad sign. Because it means that there's an outburst of violent emotion coming. This is what I saw in a dream years ago, is this sudden massive collapse of this mountain. This whole mountainside collapsed and just buried everybody. And that's symbolic of the emotionalism that's coming. And why are we doing that? To try and prove that we do have a problem. But folks, we do not have a problem. We have a continuity problem. The only problem we have is a continuity problem. So we can either go with trying to force failure, meaning that we do have a problem, there is failure, is real, try to force that by making it more intense, this dream more intense, or we can say, I don't have a problem, I only have a continuity problem. There is no world problem, there's only a continuity problem. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a spirit dream problem. I have a continuity problem. This is the way to sidestep what's going to happen in this world. The mudslide that is to come. The spirit is certainly going to dream that. Unless we insist we don't have any problem whatsoever except the continuity problem. That changes the dreaming. Spirit can back off. See, it is possible. Theoretically, it's possible. If enough of us insist that we only have a continuity problem, if we insist upon that, then we can sidestep this whole scenario, dreaming scenario. Absolutely. Will enough of us insist upon that? Maybe not. But those who do insist upon it will sidestep it. The emotionalism that's to come. Remember, when you're in this crestfallen state, you're not in an emotional state. It's beyond emotion. You're in a profound state. There's no sense of violence or acting anything out whatsoever from this crestfallen state. None whatsoever. You know, this whole idea that you're going to become violent and rape and pillage and, you know, is utter nonsense. That's what the ego wants to do. That's what the ego wants you to do, actually. In fact, the ego demands it of you. That's what I found. The ego says, no, you got to react violently to this, for sure. Everybody's fooled you. No. I only fooled myself. And I honor myself. I'm honoring myself. I'm celebrating this. There's no violence. There's no anger. This is wonderful. But, you know, wonderful crestfallenness. So the ego, again, distorts, lies, and in so many ways. I can tell you again, there is no anger in this whatsoever, this wonderful crestfallenness. There's just this wowness. Wow. It's the real wowness. It's not the real wowness of, wow, I'm really high, I'm stoned or something. No, not at all. It's deeper than that, more profound than that. Is a vast wowness. A deep, vast wowness. An immeasurable wowness. You're not engaged in trying to measure it. You're not engaged in trying to, you know, act it out so you can measure it, quantify it. The ego says, well, you must be super mad. Realize that you know, now I'm super happy that I'm going to be through with it. The ego said, well, some terrible person fooled you. No, nobody fooled me. I only fooled myself. It was to have fun, to have a whim. That's all. I'm just realizing all that anger is a waste of time. All the acting out, the violence, the anger is all a complete waste of time. Blaming someone, waste of time. Just a waste of time. All time was a waste of time. Believing in time was a waste of time. And you don't lose your sense of humor. Sense of humor is heightened, actually. Kindness is heightened. Compassion is heightened. So theoretically, the world could back away, theoretically. It is possible. And I hope there would be some great sage in the world that would help us back away. It has not happened yet. You wonder if Muji's, you know, feeling not so good and backing away and say, I'm going to have a quiet period to heal because my physical condition is not good. You know, you have to look at that and say, maybe he did everything he could do, you know, and is feeling. I noticed that he's been feeling like a bit crestfallen. It's like, wow, I want to have more of an impact on the world, you know, more. I want to be more helpful than he was able to be. And I've noticed that there's a crestfallenness there in his character. And that's showing up in his body. They may deny that, but for those very astute observers, you know, I've seen it, it's there. There's frustration there. Pretty tough not to be frustrated. And that shows up in the body. It shows up in the body. Now, teachers like that, you can see that some helpfulness to them. What I was looking for is the great helpfulness. You know, someone like Jesus, you know, the great helpfulness. The great helpfulness. There's another echelon, even, you know, more helpful than, you know, we can be helpful here, but there are those that are supremely helpful, but they haven't shown up as far as. Now, maybe they showed up by, like, Jesus giving the Course in Miracles, maybe. But again, I don't know how helpful that has really been either. It doesn't, who knows? Like, it's hard to quantify things. But can we back away as a world? Can the dream, can spirit back away from its dream? Remember, the world is just a dream of spirit. Can spirit back away on its dream, ease up on it? I don't know. Well, we'll find out. To some extent, maybe a little bit, possible. But it has to accept that it has the only problem, it has the continuity problem. There are no problems. There are no problems to solve. Continuity problem is what the Holy Spirit's problem. Okay? It's really not our problem, it's the Holy Spirit's problem. Ultimately, it's how do we wind this dream down? How does Spirit wind this dream down? Ultimately, the continuity problem could be ultimately described that way. And so God created the Holy Spirit, bless, is capable of winding this time-space dream down. Ultimate, the ultimate resolution of the continuity problem is dreaming, is Spirit dreaming in the first place. Setting dreaming down. But so by saying that we have a continuity problem, insisting that's the only problem we have, and the vision of oneness is the solution, we're putting on the Holy Spirit. We're putting this whole thing on the Holy Spirit. Because we're saying, no, there aren't any problems at all. I realize that. Except this continuity problem. And that's, Holy Spirit, that's yours. So I'm free. I'm free. So the Holy Spirit then, by the vision of oneness is basically the Holy Spirit acknowledging that you have turned this continuity problem over to the Holy Spirit. You recognize that's the only issue there is. And then in return for that, you get the vision of oneness. That confirms receipt. It's like a receipt you get. Confirms that you've given it the problem, the continuity problem to the Holy Spirit. It's a confirmation of that. That's how I see it, actually. There's a way of looking at it that seems very helpful. Kind of wheels us free of this, you know, religious paradigm that people are struggling with so badly. It puts it in a more pragmatic sense, in which I appreciate that, actually. You've turned the notion that there's a world with problems over the Holy Spirit, because you realize there isn't. And the Holy Spirit returns the vision of oneness to you in confirmation that it is that you have indeed turned it over to the Holy Spirit. And therefore now you are free to wander in this dream. and some may, you know, you'll notice a presence and say, ah, there's something, maybe I can turn the world over, the dream of the world over to the Holy Spirit too. And get the receipt. We just got a receipt for it. In exchange for that, I got this receipt, and the receipt's vision of oneness. And so the crestfallenness is actually really, we're really recognizing, oh, yeah, there's nothing to do but turn it over to the Holy Spirit now. There's nothing more to do. There's nothing to say, nothing to do, nothing to be. Nothing to know, nothing to harmonize, nothing to arrange. So there's nothing to do except turn it over, except to have a continuity problem and get the vision of oneness. That's it. Very simple. Nothing to accomplish. Nothing to accomplish. Nothing to heal. Nothing to fix. Nothing to accomplish. So this crestfallenness continues. I just reamped it. See, you know, saying that. If you want to feel that, you can do that. There's nothing. Nothing to say, nothing to do. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to say anything. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to be anything. I don't need to fix anything. I don't need to arrange anything. I don't need to heal anything. I don't need to harmonize anything. I don't need to blend anything. I don't need to work anything out. I don't need to do anything. Then you'll feel this crestfallenness. Essentially the eye evaporating. The eye is just a sense that you need to do, that something needs to be done. That's all it is. The sense that it's feeling like something needs to be done here. Something needs to be done. Who's the doer? You know, there needs to be a doer here. That's all. We just use this term I just as a word or something, but it's a sense of doership. I need to do something. Something needs to be done here. And what's evaporating is a sense that something needs to be done. Now, of course, if you believe strongly something needs to be done, this is going to be frightening. Or at least you'll believe it should be frightening. And when it's not frightening, you'll panic. And then you will go throw yourself in some frightening situation. To say, it's like this, it's like this, it's like this. It's not frightening, actually. Not at all. But we want it to be frightening because we want to succeed at failure. So we don't want to let the notion of doership go. We don't want to let it go. So we insist, oh, it's frightening, it's frightening. It's not frightening. That, again, is a arrogant presumption. It's an insistence. We insist that it's to be frightening, even though it's not. It's delusion. It's not frightening. I'm not experiencing any fear. I'm experiencing crestfallenness, but not fear. Cat says I'm sitting in his seat. That means it wants me to wrap up the video. It's kind of the producer. I have to say the cat is the producer. Okay, there's no fear here. There's no fear. When you can accept crestfallenness as crestfallenness, and accept that there isn't fear here, then you've got it. And you won't be bothered by it. You'll say, this is great. I love it. The ego just wants to hang on to doership by insisting that there must be fear about letting go of it, so that you'll be afraid to do it and won't do it. It is very simple, isn't it? There isn't any fear. That's all a lie. That's all a lie. Okay, very great. Remember, I don't have an ego problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to be anything. I don't need to heal anything. I don't need to arrange anything. I don't need to fix anything. I don't need to harmonize anything. And that's not fearful at all. Just some temporary crestfallenness of the doer, sense of doership. Letting go of the sense of doership. All right, and the cat says, that's a wrap. Very great, that's it.